Hello
and welcome to today's lecture. Today we will be studying a rather intriguing phenomena called laminar dispersion in pipe flows. This phenomena involves an interesting competition between convection or convective transport and diffusive transport, but in a way that's a bit counterintuitive and unusual. This problem also provides an excellent example of the use of perturbation methods and a good illustration of its ability to give us insight into problems short of solving problems using CFD, which is the general train of thought throughout this course. So let's take up this problem and begin by considering the general statement of what we are interested in. So the issue of dispersion revolves around the following question. If you have, let's say, flow in a channel or flow in a pipe, and you inject a pulse of dye inside this channel, the question is, you would like to know how this patch of dye, which could be a sample injected into a chromatograph, it could be pollutants released in a river, it could be something injected into the bloodstream, which is being transported by blood capillaries. In all cases, it's of interest to know when this injected sample or when this solute is going to reach a location further downstream from the point of injection. Or in other words, you would like to track the motion of this patch of solute. But along with its general, let's say, center of mass motion or its mean motion, you would also like to know how this patch of, let's say, dye is getting spread axially or longitudinally through the channel. This is especially true if you are looking at small tubes relative to the length, where you don't really care much for the radial or transverse variations in concentration, but you would certainly like to know how the concentration varies along the length. So the basic question is, how does material injected into a flow spread axially? Now this kind of spread, which is basically this axial spread, is what's known as axial dispersion or laminar dispersion if the flow is laminar. And this has applications in a whole range of phenomena. So one is, like I said, transport, let's say, of a salt sample inside blood capillaries. So if I inject a salt sample at a certain position, I would like to know how long it would take for it to get transported to some other location in the body. The same is true, let's say, for pollutants released in a river. So if pollutants are released at, let's say, some location upstream, it's of importance to know how long it would take to reach, let's say, a town or a village downstream. But now, part of this question is also requires us to know how much this pollutant, let's say, gets spread axially as it is, as its mean bulk is being transported. The reason, of course, is that if it spreads in the forward direction by dispersion, it can reach earlier than we would expect based on the calculation from the mean velocity of the flow. If it spreads backwards, then it would also persist longer at a location than one would expect if you think that it just moves with the average velocity of the fluid. This problem, of course, is again important in chromatography. Why? Because the whole idea of chromatography is to have a sample which is a mixture of many solutes. The solutes get adsorbed at different locations, and then when you pump in clean fluid, they dissolve sequentially and come out at the exit sequentially and well separated. However, the phenomenon of dispersion can cause mixing between these solutes as they are being extruded or as they are being removed out of the chromatograph, and can distort the signal. So there was also interest in understanding axial dispersion in chromatography, and in fact it was one of the motivating drives behind a deeper study of this problem. So moving on, it was also used initially as an idea or a way to measure diffusion coefficients, because as we shall see, the extent of dispersion depends not only on the fluid velocity and the fluid profile, but also on the diffusivity of the solute that you're dealing with. So it does provide a way, if you know the flow, to estimate what the diffusivity of your sample is. And then finally, the application which as chemical engineers we are all familiar with is the performance of tubular reactors. So as we know, for some applications at least, a plug flow reactor gives us ideal performance, or it is the idealized version of a tubular reactor. And one of the non-idealities arises when the plug flow does not have a plug flow profile, or for example, if it's a laminar flow in a tube. And in that case, we know that there can be mixing in the axial direction. So reactants don't simply progress through a tube uniformly across the cross section, but they mix forwards and backwards, and this can take the performance of a plug flow closer to that of a CSTR, which may be non-desirable for certain applications. And in fact, this is why to characterize tubular reactors, we do a residence time distribution analysis. And as you know, this basically involves injecting a plug of some tracer like a dye, and then watching how it's the concentration at the exit, which tells us how this injected plug or slug of material leaves the channel. If it was a plug flow, as you know, we would expect it to leave after the time given by the mean velocity, given by the length of the tube divided by the mean velocity of the flow. But in reality, we know the material starts leaving earlier, and the signal remains at the outlet much later. So, in fact, this is all due to laminar dispersion. And to get a better idea of it, we shall, in fact, begin with such an RTD experiment, but a numerical one in fluid. So, like I said, the naive expectation is that the material we inject would move with the average velocity. But this can get distorted, and it's clear to see why this won't happen when you if you have a non-uniform flow profile across the radius of a pipe, for example. Why? Because if, let's say, you insert a radially uniform concentration, a patch of material at a certain time, this pulse of material will get distorted by a non-uniform flow. Right? So at the center of the channel, fluid moves faster, it will transport the concentration or the solute faster. Whereas at the walls where you have no-slip condition, material moves at a slower speed. So this will cause this initially flat slug to get traced out and distorted in for example, a laminar flow. And so if you look at the radially average concentration, it will look like the material is being spread. And the spreading is happening, this argument at least, is purely due to convective transport, a differential convective transport. So like I said, such dispersion can cause material to arrive early and persist till late times, and also mix along the axial direction. Okay, so now let's come to this numerical experiment to give us a better idea of what we're dealing with. So this is a YouTube movie taken from the channel of Akira Ito on YouTube. The link is given below. So what this is you basically have a fluent simulation. The flow is a fully developed parabolic poiseuille flow, as shown in these profiles up above. And then you have three different kind of injection, let's say, numerical experiments with three different solutes having decreasing diffusivity as we go from the top to the bottom move. So the topmost has the maximum molecular diffusivity, and the bottom has the least. And the flow conditions are identical, so let me play this movie. And what you'll see is it will begin with a straight pulse of solute, and you'll see the solute getting distorted and axially dispersed. Okay, let me pause it here for a moment. So you saw initially the solute plug was the same, and then it begins to basically get distorted by the laminar profile. On the side here is shown what would happen if you had static diffusion. So if you just take the same pulse in a still fluid and allow only molecular diffusivity to play a role, this is what will happen. That's shown in the small box here. So you can see the top fluid diffuses the most. So in a static case, it would actually spread the most. Right? But we'll see what happens in the flow. Note already that in the early times, it does look like the slug is spreading more in the case of maximum diffusivity. But if you look more closely, you'll see in this bottom case, even though diffusivity seems to spread it less, the flow distortion itself has created a rather distorted plug or layer of solute, which means if I were to actually average the concentration across the radius, here the spread of solute in the axial direction is still more than that of this high diffusivity case. And as we watch the movie, we see that just becomes increasingly more pronounced. So you see that all the solute is confined in a relatively short region. That region extends further in the axial direction as the diffusivity reduces, to the extent where you can see a huge dispersion along the channel in the case with the smallest diffusivity, wherein pure molecular diffusivity would cause it to spread very little. The flow, non-uniform flow profile causes a large amount of axial dispersion. So the first counterintuitive thing that arises from here is because of the way the convective and diffusive transport compete in this problem, something that we will see more clearly later. We can see from this numerical experiment that the dispersion, axial dispersion, or axial spread is actually less when you have higher molecular diffusivity, which is really rather counterintuitive at first glance. Why this happens, we shall return to later once we get more insight from analysis. Now something else to note is, what's typically of interest now is not the radial and axial variation in concentration, but we are typically interested in most experiments to know the cross-sectional average concentration, how it varies along the channel, or even a simpler measurement, which is the RTD measurement, is how the concentration, the average concentration, radially average concentration, exiting from the pipe at the outlet varies. So we would like, if we were collecting fluid at the outlet and measuring the concentration, we would like to know how that concentration varies, for example. So as you can imagine, if you were measuring the concentration, you would start seeing a signal now in the bottommost case, much before you see a signal for the high diffusion case. That signal would grow and get stronger for the bottom case, and then eventually reaches a peak and then starts to decrease again. And at this stage, only now for the first time, you would see some solute leaving the case of minimum dispersion but maximum diffusion at topmost case. And eventually, you will start seeing in all cases this concentration decreasing again. Because of course, you only injected a pulse of solute, the fresh water will eventually, or the fresh fluid will eventually come in and remove all the solute. Okay, so I hope this nice movie, got, thanks to Akira Ito's YouTube channel, has given us a good feel for the problem. So let's now come back to the question of analysis, but first a little bit of history. So this problem was first studied by Taylor. And in fact, it is called now Taylor dispersion, and then sometimes also called Taylor-Addis dispersion for the contributions of Rutherford-Addis, which we shall also discuss briefly in a second. So let's pay attention to this classic paper by Sir Geoffrey Taylor, published around 1953. So he designed this, published in the Proceedings of the Royal Society A. So he designed this ingenious but simple yet elegant experimental setup where he basically has a clear glass tube with a stopper at the end, and this tube is attached to a vessel which can be maintained at a desired suction or a desired overpressure by the overhead device here. And he also has this fluid can be filled with a colored solution. I believe it was potassium permanganate, but it's some solute which gave the fluid a purple color. And he had a way by which he could inject either a constant stream of colored fluid which would enter into this tube, which was initially filled with clear water, or he could inject only a pulse of colored fluid and then again resume an injection of clear water. So you could have two conditions, one where you had colored fluid constantly being pumped in into a and therefore displacing clear fluid out of a pipe, or you could just have a slug of colored fluid in an otherwise clear flow. So we will consider the case of this slug similar to the simulation we just saw. In any case, this nice experiment, once he is able to inject this concentration, he allows it to flow for some time and then stops the flow using this outlet valve, stopper valve. And so then, because the molecular diffusivity is of his solute is so small, it, the profile of the solute attained inside this pipe when the flow is stopped persists for hours together, which allows him to conveniently measure the concentration as a function of length inside this pipe. To measure the concentration at that time in situ, while although some people use conductivity and now we have more powerful methods of measuring local concentration non-intrusively. At his time, these techniques weren't available, so he designed this ingenious method of using color calibration. So depending on that, how much this liquid gets diluted, its color changes. He therefore fixed another glass tube with a sliding rule behind the experimental flow tube, and he filled this glass tube with different concentrations of the solute, therefore with different colors, and by comparing the colors in the glass tube to the colors in his real flow tube, he could get concentrations at different, or for a fixed concentration, he could find out the axial locations where that concentration was valid. So quite a nice simple experiment, and with that he was able to get the first really clean results on this problem experimentally. And then of course, as this classic Taylorian fashion, he was able to then give a simple physically motivated theory to explain his observations. So these are his experiments. The dots are the actual measurements of concentration versus distance. Case 1, case 2 and case 3 are at three different times during the flow. So he puts in the slug, he allows the flow to proceed for some time, pauses, measures concentration, resumes the flow, pauses, measures concentration again to get case 2, and repeats the same at a later time, further time in flow history to get case 3. These lines are not theoretical predictions, they are merely fixed to guide the eye as of now, and later we shall see a comparison with theory in the same paper once we derive the theory for ourselves. The important thing to note here is you see that initially this slug is rather concentrated and narrowly distributed. With time it spreads out, actually this is a dispersion phenomena, and to satisfy conservation of mass, of course, as it spreads, the intensity of concentration also reduces. Now importantly, at the bottom you see this kind of dashed line at a very low value of concentration but uniform. This is what would have happened by the time of measurement 3 if there was no molecular diffusivity. So as we saw, molecular diffusivity reduces axial dispersion, and basically Taylor shows you that it's a huge effect. So if the solute was non-diffusive, it would have dispersed uniformly throughout the channel and at a very low concentration throughout, whereas it still maintains, that spreading is prevented greatly by the presence of molecular diffusivity, as you see here. Another thing to note is this sort of spreading that you are seeing in the axial direction looks suspiciously close to a diffusive behavior. So in other words, if you had a still fluid and you injected a pulse of concentration at time t0, that pulse would decrease in intensity while it spreads out, assuming a sort of Gaussian profile and concentration. And that's exactly what the measurements seem to indicate. And this again is a counterintuitive thing, because the axial dispersion, like I said, is controlled by the convective transport. And again, that convective transport is due to the non-uniform flow profile or the non and asymmetry inside the radial flow profile. And yet the outcome is a highly symmetric process that looks diffusive rather than convective. So this is again another reason why this phenomenon is really very intriguing. So you see convective transport giving you an effective diffusive type behavior, which is quite remarkable, and Taylor thought so himself, as he explains in the introduction of his paper, and then he goes on to explain this with the theory. Okay, so let's now come to, once we have seen these experiments, how can we understand this using a theory? So like I said, Taylor's experiment revealed some key aspects of the phenomenon, including its diffusive-like behavior. And then Taylor presented a non-rigorous argument, but based on his deep physical insight into such problems. And so using a physically motivated argument, he simplified the species transport equation and derived a result that gave insight into the diffusive-like behavior. But it was ultimately a non-rigorous, non-mathematically sound argument. So that left room for Arist to come in a few years later, around 1958 or so, and 1956, in a paper also in the Proceedings of Royal Society, where he starts with the species transport equation, which is linear in this case, and he applies the so-called method of moments. So here you average the equations, you take its first moment, which is just the mean, its second moment, which is the standard deviation, and so on. And so from the governing partial differential equations, you can derive a series of equations for the various moments, the various averages. And in the case of linear equations, you can close this system and solve it, and therefore determine how the mean concentration is transported. So Arist showed that the mean concentration, the first moment, the mean concentration gets transported with the mean velocity of the fluid, which is understandable. More importantly, he shows that the standard deviation of the concentration profile spreads in a diffusive manner, and so therefore, in a sense, explaining the diffusive-like behavior. However, this theory is, on the one hand, it's limited to only linear equations, because in the case of nonlinear equations, such moment equations cannot be closed. And secondly, the amount of insight you gain from it in terms of the competing processes is not as great. In a sense, Taylor's non-rigorous argument actually gives a better insight into the competing processes and why you get this kind of diffusive behavior. So then the third, I would think, major development in this theory was put forth by Balakutaya and co-workers, where they use an exact method of averaging, known as the Lyapunov-Schmidt reduction, developed by their group, and applied it to this problem along with perturbation theory to derive a simplified version of the species transport equation. Just as we've been doing throughout this course, taking advantage of the fact that in these laminar dispersion problems, the radius is typically much smaller than the length of the tube. Or in other words, radial diffusion is much faster than axial convection. So if you take a ratio of these time scales, it's simply the version of the Peclet number or the channel length based Peclet number. And in the limit where this Peclet number is small, you can actually do a perturbation type expansion, but in a slightly different way, known as the method of averaging, and derive a simplified model for the transport of the solute. And from that model, you can see very cleanly where this diffusive behavior arises from. And the model also gives us physical insight while at the same time being systematic mathematically. And most importantly, it also works for nonlinear equations. So for example, if you had again flow in a tubular reactor, but now with a reaction, which is of course of interest to us chemical engineers in the context of reaction engineering and tubular reactors. So if we want to solve that problem, we can use the same method of averaging for the cases of small Peclet number, and actually derive non-ideal reactor models in a rigorous manner. So instead of using the PFR, one non-ideal model is of course the axial dispersion model for a tubular reactor. But instead of simply writing it down empirically, you can actually show how that model can be derived to arbitrary levels of accuracy using perturbation methods and the method of averaging. So for this reason, this is really an interesting problem, and in this class, we will be looking at specifically the method of averaging applied to the problem of laminar dispersion in a tube. And this will not only give us deeper insight into this transport, the competition between convective and diffusive transport in a kind of counterintuitive setting, and also provide, as I said, a powerful illustration of the method of averaging, and moreover, a chance for us to deepen our insight and familiarity with perturbation theory. So with that, let's now move ahead to doing some calculations ourselves. Okay. So we are interested today as a lamina. let's take a pipe, although the same ideas work for really a channel of any cross section, although the analytical calculations proceed far easier in a pipe or a simple 2D channel. So we're looking at flow through a circular pipe. The flow profile is the usual symmetric parabolic flow profile, but we insert a slug of concentration or a solute, right, which has concentration C as a function of x and time, and we want to know how this behaves at a later time when presumably it gets distorted by convective transport. Right? And we would be interested in finding out the mean concentrations, variation as a function of C depends on x, t and r, the radial direction. Right? But we want to know the cross section average as a function of x and time, which is defined really as 0 to 2 pi. Zero to capital R, so the radius of the channel is R, right, so this is the definition of the cross section average. So this is the property we're really interested in predicting along the length, or if you just fix the x location to be, let's say, the outlet, how the cross section averages varies with time, which can be measured at the outlet. Okay, so this is roughly the setup. So the Gavni equation, where the flow velocity is known, so we don't have to solve the momentum equation, we've already done this before, and the flow profile, dimensional flow profile. Or rather, let me just write the non-dimensional version right now. So, it is given by 1 by 4 into 1 minus r square. So, the velocity goes to 0 at r equal to 1, right? So, the r characteristic is the radius of the pipe. The characteristic velocity is taken, as we have done before, as the g is the constant pressure gradient applied to drive the flow. So, g r square by mu is our velocity scale. Right? This is something that we have seen, which we have done before, of course, for the same problem. So with this scaling, this is the non-dimensional velocity. If you compute the cross-section average velocity using the same definition of the cross-section average we have here, so it's just integral, if I cancel out the integral over theta, it's integral 0 to 1 r u dr divided by integral 0 to 1 r dr. Right, this integral is just half, so it's twice the numerator. And the answer you will get is actually 1 over 8. And so therefore, you could write the velocity profile as twice the cross-section averaged velocity into 1 minus r squared. Okay, so the velocity profile is